top 10 aha moments of entrepreneurship. Let's get to it. Number 10, if it's not for you, it's okay. Really. You know, there's a lot of talk these days about entrepreneurship and how everybody should do it. And in the process of people saying that everybody should do it, sometimes what's implied is that it's easy. And it's neither. It's not easy because it's more than just about coming up with an idea. It's about putting that idea in play and executing it. My saying is, great ideas are abundant, great execution is rare. And as a result, there's a lot of uncertainty. There's no guarantees, no guaranteed paycheck. That's why it's not for everyone. So I'm the first to say, even though I'm an entrepreneurship guy, I'm the first to say, if it's not for you, it's okay. Really, because if you think it's for you, but it's not for you, and you're spending your own money, you're spending your friends and family, your family and relatives' money trying to start something up, and it's not really not for you, anything that's not for you, it's not going to work out too well. You're not going to be able to do the best you can at it, because it's just not you. And I'd give you the same advice if I were just talking to you about career choices. You look into a career, you don't think it's going to be for you, then maybe that's not the career to go with. But don't get me wrong, I'm not going to stand here and tell you it's okay to say no to every career choice and spend the rest of your life playing Xbox, PS4, trading Pokemon cards. Because that, so your parents don't have that vision of that. Someday, you have to figure out what you want to do career-wise and then decide to go after it. And that's fine. But all I'm saying is that don't do something because a whole bunch of people told you it's what you should do. Or worse, don't do something because you think if you don't do it, you'll be missing out. You really have to. You really have to have that interest and passion for whatever you end up going into. Okay, aha moment number 9. Nobody wants just another app. You know, with the explosion of smartphones, the Android platform, the iOS iPhone platform. The gold rush of entrepreneurship seems to have been, all I have to do is come up with an app, and I'll be the next Angry Birds, Temple Run, Minecraft, and I'll be rich, and I can go buy an island in the Caribbean. Well, here are the hard statistics. Android platform, 800,000 apps plus. In the iOS iPhone, over 1.2 million apps. So you take the total of 2 million apps, and add up all the revenue and divide by 2 million to get the average, and this includes the gazillion earning apps and those that have hardly sold any at all, the average revenue per app is only $3,000. That's not enough to have a going concern. So the apps that make it are apps that are targeted for a particular application, a particular utility, a particular value proposition, like this app called WhatsApp. You guys have heard of it or not, but they basically provide free mobile messaging services, video, audio, text, that sort of thing. But that app uses the phone's data plan instead of the SMS plan. Okay? WhatsApp has, get this, you don't have heard the brand that much, 400 million active users. 400 million a second only from Facebook's 1.2 billion active users, and more than Twitter's 235 million active users. And that's for a brand that's not really that well known. It's been out for 4 years now. So again, there's no overnight successes in entrepreneurship. They're profitable, they hardly spend money on marketing. It's a targeted app. Here's an interesting one I thought I'd show you, Backdoor. It's an app that allows you to send anonymous text messages to your friends, but give them clues on who sent the text message. Don't get any idea. Now, I'm not exactly sure from a business standpoint why that's useful when you think about it. But at least one seed investor does, because that app, founded by Daniel Singer, just garnered in the last 2-3 weeks an investment of $200,000 to fill out their technology and acquire global markets and other markets. Daniel Singer, ladies and gentlemen, is 14 years old. So that's about the age of some of you 8th and 9th graders, I imagine. got to be a targeted app. It can't be another app. Nobody wants another app. Aha moment number eight. Don't be a dreamer. Be a doer. A lot of entrepreneurs, too many of them, think that all they have to do is come up with an idea. And they think that the essence of entrepreneurship is just coming up with that idea. Remember what I said a little while ago, my mantra. Great ideas are abundant, great execution are rare. It's all about the execution. It's what you do with the idea that makes you an entrepreneur. You come up with an idea, you do nothing with it. I'm sorry to tell you, you're not an entrepreneur, at least not in my eyes. So there are a lot of people that talk about doing stuff, and they never do anything. They can't find excuses. You know, there's a popular home finance program called Quicken by the Intuit Corporation. One of my friends from California years ago told me that he had the idea for a home finance program application 3 full years before Quicken introduced their product release. 3 full years. So, in essence, he's saying, I came up with Quicken before Quicken did. But he was not the one who released it. Why did he do it? That's the difference between being a dreamer and not being a dreamer. Aha, number seven, dream before doing. Now, notwithstanding what I said about aha number eight, you've got to do some dreaming before you do. You just can't go out and do. So if I equate the word dream with vision, and I equate the word do with action, there's a saying that goes like this. Vision without action is merely a dream. Action without vision just passes the time. Vision with action can change the world. And it's really true that you need a bit of both. You absolutely need both. Here are two guys that have done it and have changed the world. Mr. Jeff Bezos, founder of Amazon.com. He's actually a Princeton graduate. A few years after Mr. Garcia and I finished at Princeton. And I believe he went on to Harvard and got his MBA. And took a sort of a traditional job, if you will, with investment banking over in Wall Street. So one day he had this dream, and I'm not saying that he slept and he had a dream, but he had this vision of wanting to sell books over the internet. And this is in the early 90s at a time when it hadn't been done yet. So he goes for a walk in Central Park with his boss. And he tells his boss about this vision of his, about selling books on the internet. And you know what his boss says? Boss says, that sounds like a great idea for a job for an unemployed guy that doesn't have a great job like an investment banking position like you've got, Jeff. Not very encouraging. Remember what I said? Entrepreneurship's not for everybody. So it certainly didn't seem like he was for his boss. So Jeff's vision was so strong, he decided to just quit his job. Quit his job outright. Not right then on the walk to Central Park, but he probably talked to his wife a bit and thought about more that sort of thing. The thing he wanted to show his boss said, it was the right type of job for an unemployed guy. So he quit his job, he was by pack up all their stuff in the car, and they made the drive from New York City to Seattle, Washington. And during that drive, I'm sure he had worked on his business plan prior to setting up the drive, but he finalized his business plan. When they got to Seattle, and wherever the residence was, he set up shop in his garage by himself and started Amazon.com. The rest is history. You can arguably say that he changed the world of e-commerce, and just the way that we look at retail today. Vision with action. Bill Gates, Microsoft Corporation. Very few people get to claim that they changed the world once. Bill Gates, in essence, his legacy will show he has changed the world not once, but twice. The first time, when he founded Microsoft, his vision of a personal computer operating systems, the applications, all that stuff involves, put it together and created Microsoft, a huge company, huge success. You can argue all you want about whether PCs are harder to operate than Mac or what have you, but Microsoft is a resounding success in that regard. It continues to be very, very profitable. So that's world changing number one. As he stepped away from the day-to-day of Microsoft, he created with his wife Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, which is a charitable foundation that applies money to solve some of the world's hardest problems, like global health, world hunger, and then here at home, the U.S. education system. Vision with action can change the world. Aha moment number six. Work hard. Work smart. Learn fast. Success can be had by doing those three things. Let's look at some examples. So Facebook and Mark Zuckerberg, they've been around forever, it seems. In fact, they just celebrated their 10th anniversary. But when Mark was at Harvard, he worked hard. Maybe he didn't work as smart, but he worked hard on his idea at Harvard. And then when he left Harvard and went to Facebook full-time, I'm sure he worked smarter, worked just as hard, if not harder. And he's got to learn fast, too, because the dynamics in his market change. Even today, as successful as Facebook is, the pundits say it's not going to be around much longer, and this and that. You know, this. People take shots at you when you're at the top. That just goes with the territory. But he has to live by those three activities to find God. They recognize tall, beautiful Maria Sharapova, women's professional tennis player, currently ranked number three in the world, 29 singles titles, including four majors. She is only 26 years old. She works hard, trains constantly, works smart, scouts for competition to see how they've upgraded their skills so she can stay ahead of them. She's had some surgery issues with her shoulder and all that, so that has caused her to work hard. And she has to learn fast for the things that she wants to do. Maria has a weakness and passion for candy. So she started her own company. It's a candy company called Sugar Poba. Interestingly enough, she was going to change her name from Maria Sharapova to Maria Sugar Poba, but I think either her mother or her agent talked her out. But she has to learn fast enough about the candy company that she has no familiarity or experience. Beyonce Knowles, you all know as Beyonce, recording artist, touring singer, net worth, $350 million. It's mostly about her music and her touring and all that, but this is a shot of her website that sells her clothing and apparel. She has a line of clothing that she markets. Again, she had to learn fast to put that out, and she recently introduced a cosmetics line as well, too, which is a new line of business that she's not necessarily that familiar with, where she would have to keep up and keep going. Aha, number five, to make our way halfway through the list here. Know the real meaning of courage. Here's Mark Twain, famous author. He wrote, I want you to pay particular attention to this meaning of courage. Courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is taking action despite fear. So what does that mean when you hear that? That means it's okay to be scared. And even the most courageous people will tell you that they've been scared at different times in their careers or in their lives. Where you get in trouble with fear is that it paralyzes you to the point where you don't do anything. You don't want to reach for that next achievement. You don't want to take a chance to get to that next level. You don't want to see if you can get that next breakthrough because you don't want to fail. You're afraid to fail. Courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is acting despite fear. So, at some point when you do face fear, and you will, you remember this, set your sights on what you're going to do. Aha, moment number four, stare down adversity and failure. And there are very few really successful people that you will run into that have not run into any kind of adversity or failure. And there are very, very successful people that have run into failure many, many times. So I'll share some of them with you. This gentleman here is James Dyson. His vacuum cleaners carry his name, the Dyson vacuum cleaner. It's a premium line of vacuum cleaners. Sells somewhere between $400 and $700. Grown-ups in the room, I don't know how you feel about it, but I'm not sure that I'd pay $700 for a machine that picks up dirt. But there's plenty of other people that decide that that's the product for them. Mr. Dyson is a billionaire as a result of that. But here's the interesting thing. Did you know that Mr. Dyson produced 5,127 prototypes over a 5-year period before he released his first Dyson vacuum cleaner? 5,127. 127 over 5 years. If you do the math, that's one new prototype every day for every weekday of 5 years. I guess he took the weekends off and didn't do a prototype then. And he says that after prototype number 15, his third child was born. After prototype number 2,627, they were counting the pennies he and his wife. And after prototype number 3,627, his wife was giving art lessons to raise some extra cash. He released his first Dyson vacuum cleaner, became successful, went from there. Like I said, he's a billionaire. He stared down failure to reach success. Dr. Seuss, his first book, I think I saw it on Mulberry Street. He went out to get it published, approached all his publishers to try to get it published. 27 publishers turned him down. 27. I don't know about you, but most people start getting a little discouraged after maybe 12, 13, 14. 27 publishers. And on the 28th one, he ran into an old college classmate who's working at Vanguard Press. Entrepreneurship, by the way, does take a little luck sometimes. It doesn't hurt. It's kind of like saying to golf. It takes skill to get it close, it takes luck to get it in. Vanguard Press went on to publish the book, which ultimately sold 6 million copies. You can imagine how those other 27 publishers felt after they saw those sales figures. He stared down rejection and failure to touch success. The face and logo you recognize, Steve Jobs of Apple Computer. It seems like the late Steve Jobs, and it seems like everything he touched of late before he passed away turned to gold. But it wasn't always that way. Steve first started Apple. The Apple One was a terrible one. It didn't work that great. But the lessons he learned from that failure led to the Apple II, which was actually a decent machine that created some cash flow for the company, and led to the Apple III, which was not really very good, and then the Lisa computer, which was pretty bad, actually very expensive, not practical. And that's what got Steve kicked out of his own company. And then he started a company called Next Computer Systems. And that didn't actually do that great. But years later, when he came back into Apple, through an acquisition of some sort, that's when he started dreaming of the eyes. iPod, iMac, iPad, iPhone, and all that. And that's what turned Apple into the leader that it was. So he stared down failure to reach success. And finally, the last example, Sir Richard Branson, founder of Virgin Records and Virgin Atlantic Airways. And about 400 other Virgin brands as well, too. And he's the classic saying, you've got to learn from your failures. There's another saying that failure is feedback. You take your failures and understand it as feedback, what you can do better and what you did well, and take the lessons from that. But Branson's companies that he started under the Virgin label, not all of them were successful, but many of them were failures. Virgin Brides, Virgin Cola, Virgin Cars, Virgin Cosmetics, Virgin Clothing, Virgin Digital. Those are all failures. They weren't his first, they won't be his last either. He reaches through the adversity and failure to find success. Aha moment number three. It's not about you, it's about your customers and what they do. Too many times entrepreneurs are mistaken. They think that the story is about what they've done and it's all about them. So they invented this great thing and that's what the story's about. That's what you should focus on. And that's wrong. It's backward. It's about what your customers want and how you as an entrepreneur can serve those customers and help their lives and their businesses be better as a result of your products and services. Zappos.com is a site that sells lots of shoes and a lot of other personal effects and clothing, accessories and stuff. Founder Tony Hsieh knew it's not about that. It's about their customers who are looking for great product selection, fair prices, and awesome customer service. By the way, Zappos not only includes free shipping, but it also includes free return shipping if you don't like what you bought and you want to return it. So it makes it a risk-free internet shopping experience. And that's the kind of philosophy about thinking about what their customers want and allow that company to go to the billion-dollar level very, very quickly. Howard Schultz at Starbucks Coffee, he knew it's not about the coffee that they serve. It's about the coffee that their customers are looking for as they come into the stores flavors, and also the experience of getting the coffee, you know, the baristas, and music, and Wi-Fi, and all that good stuff. It's about the customer. And what about this? This is a very dark logo here because of the lighting, but that is the GoPro logo. And underneath it has a slogan, says, be a hero. So if you've watched the X Games at all on ESPN, the GoPro cameras are the ones that are strapped to the helmets of the skateboarders, the snowboarders, and extreme skiers. And you know, when they show that, you're like, ugh! They're doing a 360-degree turn and all that stuff. They're the leader in the marketplace with that type of camera. Founder Dick Whitman, he knew it was about the athletes and what kinds of experiences they wanted to reflect in the footage and the kind of footage that they wanted to take, because they've got 180-degree views, and I think they've developed a 360-degree camera. That type of focus on the customer, what they want, has allowed this guy, Nick Whitman, the founder of the company, to be one of the youngest billionaires ever in Silicon Valley. This camera company is the fastest growing camera company in this category today. It's not about you. It's about your customers. All right, we're getting down to the end of the countdown here. Aha moment number two, dare to innovate. By that, I mean dare to be different. Don't take the same road of doing what everybody else has done, trying to get in on the action. Because ultimately, that doesn't lead to making enough difference as an entrepreneur. Let's take a look at some examples. Here's a product I know you've seen ads on. 5-hour energy. So you might say, hey, it's an energy drink, lots of energy drinks out there, what's so innovative about that? Well, it turns out at the time that 5-hour energy got released, most of the energy drinks that were out there were 8 to 10 ounces. So you had to drink 8 to 10 ounces to get that energy boost. And the founder of 5-hour energy reasoned that, well, let's see, not everybody wants to drink 8 to 10 ounces of liquid for that energy boost because it can make them feel full or sloshy. And so he came up with a formulation that gives that energy boost in 2 ounces. It's not as easy as it sounds. You know, it's not just coming up with an energy drink and taking a quarter of it because you won't get that same boost. So he had to figure the formula that gave the same end result effect to just 2 ounces. And that's what's allowed them to build their business. Here's a product called the Pebble Watch, invented by a guy named Eric Michikowski. The Pebble Watch is a watch that takes information relayed to your smartphone and displays it on that watch, which is kind of a precursor to the Samsung watches that you've seen recently advertised. About a $250 product. Eric created the company, created the product, and initially raised financing the more conventional way through venture capital, to the tune of about $375,000. He went through that venture capital, and when he went to go raise another round, he could not. Just wasn't getting any interest or any traction on being able to do that. So, just dared to innovate on that theme. He dared to innovate to come up with a Pebble Watch to start with. And then he dared to innovate from a financial standpoint, and he went to the crowdsourced funding site Kickstarter to raise more money. He put an initial campaign target of $100,000, which was exceeded in the first 2 hours that it was on Kickstarter. And by the end of the 30-day period, which is the typical length of a campaign on Kickstarter, the Pebble Watch campaign set a new record that still stands today. The total after 30 days, the total number of dollars pledged at the end of 30 days was about $10.2 million. And that today is still the record on Kickstarter. And that was pledged by a total of about 69,000 people. So Eric dared to innovate product-wise and from a financial standpoint in how he raised his money. This product down here, well, first of all, you all know about scanners. You take an image, put it on the scanner, scan it in, creates a file on your hard drive, manipulate the file, and print it out. Well, this is a company called MakerBot. The product is called a digitizer. And the MakerBot digitizer allows you to scan in a solid 3D object like that gnome there in the picture. As long as it fits into an 8x8x8-inch scan space. It creates a file, you've manipulated it, and here's where the innovation part comes in. When you take that file and use one of MakerBot's 3D printers to print it, you have effectively a Xerox copy for solid objects. That's cool. about $1,400. And finally, startup company in Silicon Valley, I think the north of San Jose, north of San Francisco, Boosted Boards, came out with this skateboard, longboard, that has been referred to as probably the lightest battery-operated vehicle on Earth. The lightest battery-operated vehicle on Earth. It's battery-operated, has a top speed of 20 miles per hour. Are you listening, guys? 20 miles per hour, mostly can run 6 miles on a single charge, and apparently only takes 2 hours to recharge to full. They also used Kickstarter for their funding as well. They started with a $100,000 pledge target. By the end of 30 days, I think they raised almost $500,000, maybe $475,000. So, guys and gals, you got your sights set on this for your next Christmas or Hanukkah list. You better start lobbying early, because one of these will set your parents back $1,300. It better be extra good if that's what you're looking for next holiday season. These companies all dare to innovate, not only just for products, but in the way they fund their companies. Finally, aha moment number one, we've reached the end of our list. Have passion for whatever you do. And whether you start your own business, or whether you go work for somebody else, I believe you have to have the passion for whatever it is that you're doing. Business is hard. If you go work for somebody else, there'll be challenges. If you come work for yourself, there'll be even more challenges. There's ups and downs, and if you're not passionate about, at least interested in what you're doing, then those hard times will just take you down if you feel like quitting. You feel like quitting anyway, but if you have passion about something, you know that you can't quit. Passion can lead to success. At Nike, founder Phil Knight first founded the company with the passion of finding better technology running shoes for runners across the country. Nike was a runner in his college days. And over the years, as the company grew, that passion became finding better athletic equipment for athletes in different sports, not just running. That singular focus is what has helped keep the company going and growing. I know you know this logo, and I know you've eaten there sometime in the recent past, maybe even this morning. Founder Ray Kroc, when he first met the McDonald's brothers, in a restaurant in the Midwest, became singularly focused on this hamburger experience, efficiently delivering the hamburger meal and all the fixings around it, and the experience that's involved when you come in and get it, that sort of fast food concept. Then he bought the company from the McDonald's brothers, kept the name, so that he could put it in his own system and really perfect it. And he just, over the decades, all the way through the time he passed away, just focused on that, because the core driving part of their business. How do you deliver that hamburger meal experience in all of what it entails? And that focus has continued since the founder's death many years ago, and that's what makes McDonald's such a success, a singular focus on that project. Today, McDonald's is a company with 34,000 restaurant locations worldwide. And do you know that every day it's said 69 million people eat at McDonald's every single day. 69 million people. That's sure a lot of fries. And that's how passion can breed success. And I hope someday each of you will be doing something where you can say, I'm loving it. So there we have the top 10 aha moments of entrepreneurship. And I hope that one or two, or maybe more of them, you'll carry away with you through the years, whether or not you decide to become an entrepreneur. Because I think that can help you just in life. I'm going to close with this view from the International Space Station, looking down upon where we're sitting right now. Kind of make out in the lower right corner there, Long Island, the shape of a fish, and a cluster of lights at the head of the fish in New York City in the metropolitan area. You go a little west, southwest, and that's about where we're sitting. And certainly, if you have a view like this, you feel like you're sitting on the top of the world. And so, as you imagine what it's like to sit on top of the world, and think about the potential of your years ahead, I want to leave you with these three parting thoughts that I hope you remember. Even if you remember nothing else at all about what I said this morning, I hope you remember these three parting thoughts. Parting thought number one, dare to be yourself. Dr. Seuss once said, be who you are, say what you feel, because those who mind don't matter, and those who matter don't mind. Parting thought number two, dare to work hard without any guarantees. You know, success is never guaranteed, but it's only available for those who work hard. And finally, parting thought number three, dare to dream big, take action, and make a difference. I thank you, and I wish you well.